In the deep dark hills of eastern Kentucky, that's the place where I trace my bloodline. And it's there I read on a hillside gravestone, you will never leave Harlan alive.
This is the Citadel Cafe. This is the Citadel Cafe, episode number 77, recorded live Wednesday, August 28th, 2013. I am Joel Duggan, and this evening to my right is Mr. Lou Page of the Zombies Ate My Podcast. Or should I just, is it just Zombies Ate My Podcast? Like, how do you guys do that?
It's just Zombies Ate My Podcast.
Yeah, I was thinking about that going in, I was like, am I going to fumble this? Am I going to have to carry this through and
believe it or not, I think redundant? This is the first time it's been redundant or fumbled.
Well, you know, there's a first time for everything, and if we've learned anything from the internet, is that the redundant internet is redundant.
Yes.
I'm just speaking like the hip kids now, right? I'm appealing to the younger demographic.
Hey, you got to try something.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, this is going to be an interesting show, folks. We've got lots of stuff on the go, but what we're going to do a little bit later on, just as a heads up, is get into some Hemlock Grove spoiler talk. We will let you know when it's coming. You don't have to worry about being accosted with our series information should you not want to listen, have not seen it, have not finished the series yet. The good news is that it's a Netflix series, so you can watch it all in one go and then listen to the rest of our show. But we'll give you plenty of heads up before we get into that. We'll probably tag that at the end of the movies, TV, and video section of our show. And if you happen to be new to the Citadel Cafe, this is where myself and a guest usually come to hang out, talk about the cool stuff that we're into. Could be comic books, could be books, which is, again, another redundant term. Could be music, could be websites, could be movies and television. If we think it's cool, we're going to let you know. And right now, the only thing that I have to fill you guys in on how my week is that I am finally, after a back injury, back into running. And holy shit, am I tired. I thought working out was supposed to give you more energy. It did when I was 25. At 34 and a half, close enough to 35 to call it a round number, it does not give me more energy. It takes away energy. I am old and tired. I don't like it.
Today was actually my first day back at the gym.
Oh, nice.
It's kind of, my wife and I have been slacking off, so we kind of decided after our anniversary that this was going to be the thing. We're going to start getting back into a routine. So that was the first thing I did after I got out of work today, and I am out of shape again.
Aren't we all?
Yeah.
It's the end of summer, though. Shouldn't we be in, like, beach shape? You know, like, we should have, like, six-pack abs and...
I've spent more time this summer inside than outside. It's been one of those summers.
Yeah, I know. I know what you mean. I've been spending a lot of time in the studio as well, and I'm glad that I have an air conditioner, because there's been a couple days this summer that have just been absolutely crazy humid here in Halifax, and I'm glad to have at least the comfort in my little 8x10 studio. Although, I was outside quite a bit on the weekend. Jocelyn and I had some house guests in, and we took the opportunity to show them around the province. They've not been here before. I mean, by province, I mean kind of like the HRM, kind of drivable distance within a couple hours. So right. We went down to Peggy's Cove, took some pictures, had some seafood chowder, and had a big lobster boil and a rib barbecue. We were out to some pubs, had some live music. Like, it was a really, really good weekend with friends. And man, did it ever feel good to be outside after all the time I've been spending inside. Like, I noticed I really did notice it when I was sitting having a beer at the Celtic Corner listening to, like, a live, you know, Celtic band. I mean, the guy was Irish, you know, play. And it was just like, God, I need to get out more. I need to not work so much and get out a little bit more for a pint or two or eight.
It's always good to get out. I went to a zoo this past weekend.
Oh, cool.
There's a zoo here in Maine, which is kind of the backwater of anywhere. So we've always joked that the zoo must be full of animals that are like really old. But surprisingly, Maine has a really nice zoo.
Does it really?
I've lived here for 15, 20 years, never been to the zoo here.
I figured it'd be mostly amazed. Like deer, bears.
They had a deer petting zoo. Mm-hmm. They had pigs. And I was like, oh, they have the stereotype. But they had a butterfly sanctuary where you walk in and the butterflies are like flying around your head. And it was really interesting. And they had tigers and lions. And I was like, I wonder what they do with these in winter, because Maine weather is not suitable for animals like this.
Yeah, we've got a zoo here in Nova Scotia that has some African animals, like I think there's a leopard and I think a lion as well. And they just do like a hothouse. It's an old farm, so it's a barn that's been converted into kind of a temperature maintained sanctuary for them in the wintertime. But you'd be surprised. The zoo opens up and the animals are outside quite early spring into late fall.
Wow.
Like it's only when things start to dip below like 10 degrees here, and don't ask me to do the math, I don't know what that is in Fahrenheit, but it's 10 degrees above freezing.
Right.
So, you know, cold enough in the evenings that it's cool, but it's not, there's no frost on the ground. And I would imagine that they probably go inside at night, but I don't know what they do during the day, but once the frost hits, of course, the zoo is closed.
I've lived in the Northeast most of my life, but it's always baffled me that there are zoos here. I'm like,
Yeah, you think that's mostly like a San Francisco or Georgia, that sort of thing, the southern states. So I know that, I mean, New York has a big zoo, doesn't it?
It does, but most of that's inside, I think.
Yeah, and that's the thing that I find really kind of odd. I mean, zoos like that are kind of akin to circuses for me. Like, they're not really natural habitat. Where, I mean, not that, you know, a farm in Nova Scotia is the natural habitat for an African lion, but it, at least it's wide open spaces, you know, grassy plains, fenced in, you know, that kind of stuff. And I mean, chances are, I mean, I doubt very much that someone in Nova Scotia had the money to bring an African lion to here. I would imagine it was probably rescued from captivity or something.
Donated
or something like that, where it was already probably born and bred in captivity, wouldn't make it in the wild, and therefore they have to, you know, keep an eye on it as opposed to letting it loose in the Nova Scotia forests, which would be no fun for anybody.
No, not at all.
And we were talking just pre-show, so I'll put you on the spot and say happy anniversary to you and your wife.
Thank you. Three years,
right?
Yes. Yes, and I won't screw it up this time because I thought it was three.
I said three.
Oh, you did. Oh, I thought you said two. No, it's been two.
Your wife doesn't listen to this, does she?
No.
Sorry, I totally dog-eared you into that one.
That's all right. It's all right.
Well, over the last weekend when we had guests here, they arrived a little bit late on Friday and they were tired from traveling. So we decided to go take in a movie. And it was the first time that I've been to the theaters since, I want to say Pacific Rim was the last thing that I saw. I really haven't taken in much for summer blockbusters. So it was Jamie and Preston, our guests, Jocelyn's friend Jamie and her fiance Preston. And they're around our age. And into the same sort of stuff. So we went to go see Elysium because they thought it was a cool trailer. And I remember really liking District 9. And so we decided to go check it out. And it was crazy loud, despite the fact that we sat in the back of the theater. It was one of those enhanced theater viewings.
Oh, those can be rough.
Yeah. So it was a little bit much for me because there's a lot of like explosions and, you know what I mean? When like it's the, what was that movie by Christopher Nolan, with the dream stuff with DiCaprio? Inception?
Inception.
Yeah. So it's like the Inception brown note every 3 minutes.
Oh,
you know, like, great. You know, it gets kind of repetitive. And when it's that loud, it can be a little bit off-putting, but, the director Neil Blomkamp, did a very good job on District 9, which I really, really liked when I saw it in the theaters. It was very different.
It was the first Blu-ray I actually bought.
Oh, wow.
That was kind of what sold me on Blu-ray.
Mm. I've never seen it since, and I would like to because I remember it being very good. Unfortunately, Elysium feels like District 9 too. Did you see
That's
it?
Kind of. I have not seen it, but that was kind of what I was afraid of.
Yeah. So I mean, I'll be careful. Do you care about spoilers?
I do not care.
You don't care about spoilers. Okay. Well, so folks, I'm not going to spoil the end of the movie or anything like that, but I was certainly not going to hold back on my thoughts. Like I said, it felt like District 9 too. I understand that director is, I believe, from South Africa, and he wants to give back to his community. And I mean, from the look of it, even though it was supposed to be Southern Los Angeles in a post-apocalyptic kind of situation, you could just tell that it was South Africa again.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it really doesn't have all, like, and it's not just the location, it's the art direction as well. The tones, the grays, the browns, the greens, they're all kind of the same. Now, it's not all like that, because the idea behind the movie is that the rich and powerful have moved to a disease-free, free medical coverage kind of space station called Elysium. And that's all white and crisp and the farthest thing from District 9 you could imagine. So there is a parallel that I quite enjoyed. But most of the movie is dark, dirty, and gritty, which is one thing I do like about Blomkamp's sci-fi, is that it's not all shiny all the time. You know, like, he's got some teeth to his stories, which I enjoy. Matt Damon was really good in it. He plays a, not a construction worker, but he's a factory worker, and he makes the robots that police the citizens on Earth and keep everybody in line. And they're all basically just making stuff that keeps the space station running. That's what everybody's job is. It's like slave labor.
Right.
And they all, everybody's sick, everybody's dying, no one has health coverage. It's all a big expense. The hospitals are overrun. Like, it really just feels like, although I can appreciate putting real world problems into a sci-fi film and just kind of fast forwarding by 200 years, it really didn't feel like much of an original tale.
Yeah, it felt a little too real.
It just felt a little bit too, I get this on the evening news.
Yeah. Yeah. You know?
So yes, I guess too real would be the thing. Well, and again, like, I don't necessarily want to say that it's a bad thing that he's making a social commentary with his movie.
No.
I think it's good to have better writing and deeper meaning to sci-fi films as opposed to just shoot 'em up, you know, action stuff like what Schwarzenegger used to be in. I don't know. Like I said, it had a better sort of story than most sci-fi films, but it had less action than most sci-fi films. So all the cool stuff that you want to see in, say, like a Star Wars movie, you wanted from this movie, but you didn't get it. There's this exoskeleton that he wears, and he's basically only has a few days to live, so he's just trying to get up to Elysium to fix himself. And help some friends, and he, in order to do that, he has these thugs install this giant kind of exoskeleton that gives him superpower sort of thing, super strength. But he's awfully good with guns and combat, considering that he's just a construction worker. So that kind of stuff was a little bit foggy, and there's a lot of stuff that you don't expect from Blomkamp, which was, you know, the slow motion shot of the giant machine gun just firing away as the bullet casings are trickling to the ground, and just like whoop 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 whoop, and you're just kind of like, this is needless. Like, I don't care. You know, I'd much rather see something cleverly cut together with some fast paced action, because that's what your movie needs right now. Because I mean, I wasn't bored, but it was slow in some parts.
That surprises me.
Yeah, me too. I mean, it was the same kind of pace as District 9. I mean, District 9 had some upbeat moments, but most of it was kind of this, like, march, right? It's a very steady beat to the whole movie. The villain was creepy, but not threatening. He was this skinny South African guy. I want to say it might be the same guy that was in District 9. Is it the same guy?
It's the same guy.
Is it the same guy? He's awful. He's absolutely awful. You can't understand anything he says.
Really?
Yeah.
I actually heard somebody say that he was the best part of the movie.
Eh.
And I was like, huh.
He would have been a really, you know, he would have been better suited to play the role that Matt Damon played.
I'm sure he probably would have.
You know, and it's just, he's just not intimidating at all. He's crazy, but he's hobo crazy. He's not like psycho guy's going to rip your arms off crazy. He's just like off his rocker. And he's supposed to be like this military specialist and stuff, but he doesn't at all look or feel the part. And him and several of his other, you know, because he's got his like squad, his commando squad that all work with him. And they're talking back and forth. I mean, I don't want to sound horrible here, but I mean, like, and it could have been the theater, but I really couldn't understand what they were saying. And neither could the rest of the people I saw the movie with. Jocelyn and Jamie and Preston were all like, you got the gist because the story wasn't too complicated, but you missed the whatever they were going to say, you know, what they said, something, 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 this location. He's like, okay, well, I think they found what they were looking for, but I really didn't understand what that dude just said.
Right.
You know, because it was too fast with too heavy of an accent. And I mean, possibly I'm just not used to it. I mean, like, I can watch movies when people have French accents and I understand it. But, you know, put me in a movie where someone's got like a Swedish accent and I might not. You know, so I just, it's probably just, you know, some time getting used to seeing films with South African accents and stuff in them. But yeah, it's just, it wasn't really my cup of tea. It was also gory, which I do remember from District 9.
District 9 was gory, but the gory kind of had a point.
Yeah.
It wasn't just there to, like, shock you. It was like, oh, that's there to make a point.
Yeah, like when he was changing or like, when he had a weapon or something, it was meant to, like, you have to understand how powerful this weapon is and it blows somebody into bits or something like
right,
that.
Right, right.
Well, every time he turned around, somebody was stepping on a grenade. And, I mean, giblets went everywhere. And it was, I mean, CG, but very right. believable CG with some serious sound effects. And there was also some parts where, you know, people's faces or heads or stuff were getting hit. And he was like, wow, like, I don't know if I necessarily need to see that. So yeah, it was a little bit of a shock. And I still don't know whether it added to the film or not, because it had weight. Like, I mean, if it was a bad guy or if it was, you know, an innocent that was getting killed as a bystander, like, it had a point to it. And I'm sure that some of that is, like, you know, sure, like, some of the violence that happens in the world today, you know, as opposed to just, you know, reading or hearing about it on the evening news, someone has to say, no, look, this is what happens when, you know, innocents get caught in the crossfire, and it's disturbing, and all that kind of stuff. I get that, but I don't know if I necessarily need it in this kind of a movie. I feel like it was advertised one way and it was a different film.
That kind of happens to directors like him.
Mm-hmm.
They don't
know
how to sell his product, so they really just want to fill the seats, so they kind of mislead you a little bit.
Yeah, and he's got a much bigger budget than before, and it was a great looking film. Like the cinematography and the special effects and all that kind of stuff. Like I said, it's gritty sci-fi. When there's a hovercraft, it looks like it would work. Like it doesn't have any magic to it. It just, you can see the propellers. You can, you know, understand, all right, I get it. That's believable. That kind of looks like the cross between a big troop transport airplane, something that carries like a Jeep or something inside of it. But instead of wings, it's got like four helicopter takeoff and landing things. Like it makes sense. All that kind of stuff, all of the art direction, while similar to District 9, was not bad. It was just very, very identifiable with Blomkamp and his tastes and stuff like that. If you haven't seen District 9, you might not notice any of this stuff.
Right.
Or care. And some people that are not a fan of District 9 and wanted something more mainstream might also be something that's up their alley. Yeah. So what's been on your screens these days?
Well, I know we don't normally talk about games here, but I want to plug a game here that's pretty amazing.
No, man, go ahead. We've been inching into games more and more lately.
There is an indie game that just came out called Gone Home, and it is unlike any experience in gaming I've ever had.
I've actually heard about this.
I'm sure you have. It's been making its rounds, and I think Ryan may have talked about it last week briefly on Gamers Inn. It is a fully story-driven game. There are no puzzles, and the only reason to play the game is to work your way through the story. It's a totally immersive experience. You play a girl named Katie who's been on like a extended European hike for the past year, kind of like before she goes off to college. And while she's been gone, her parents moved to a new town. They inherited a house from an uncle and they've all moved into the house. And it's like she's come back from her trip early. And when she gets home, there's nobody there. And so you go into the house and there's a note on the door from your sister saying, "I've left. Don't tell mom and dad not to bother trying to find me." And you're like, okay, so what's going on? And so it's this big mansion and you have to find the key to the front door, figure out like where they would have stashed it on the front porch. You go into the house and then you wander through the house and it's like you pick up the mail on the counter and you shuffle through the mail. And it's like you have to put together the story of what happened for the past year while you've been gone and why this house is alone. Why is there's nobody home?
Right. So this house is the inherited house. It's the...
Yes.
Oh, okay. Right on.
So nobody knows why. You know that your parents moved there. You don't know why. So you've got to figure that out. And so it's like they do a really good job of you identify with the character because you don't know anything going into it either, and neither does she.
Oh, cool.
And there's certain pieces. There's several stories going on while you're putting all of this together. It's like you get the story of your sister and what happened to her for the past year. And you find out that the house might be haunted. So, like, wandering around the house is kind of creepy because all the lights are out.
Well, I'm looking at the pictures now. Yeah, it looks kind of creepy.
Yeah, it's really creepy and spooky, and you don't know anything. So you're wandering around this house trying to flip on lights. There's a TV on in one of the rooms. So you hear this noise from down the hallway, and you're like, is there somebody home? What's going on? And you go on, and there's like a news report airing on the TV. And it's like, oh, okay, I'll turn this TV off so that this doesn't bother me anymore and distract me. And it's like everything is pick up and everything can be read.
And that's really cool.
Unfortunately, it's $20 and it took me about 3 hours to finish. But I'm very happy that I spent the money on the game. It was well worth the money, but I can see why some people would say it wasn't. And I won't spoil any of the plot, no nothing. But if you're looking for something, even if you're not a gamer and you're looking for an interesting story experience, it's well worth your money.
Yeah, it sounds closer to an interactive movie experience than an actual game.
It is. And to be honest, might hit you a little close to home like it hit me close to home. Game takes place in 1995.
so it's a period piece then.
It's a period piece. That way they could explain why you hadn't talked to your parents. Because phones are expensive to dial from Europe home and stuff.
Clever.
And so there's a lot of like tapes are in the house. And you'll open up a cupboard and it kind of hit me close to home because there's like stuff that people recorded off of TV with like several movies on a tape. And we did that in my house all the time. Oh, this is going to be on TV. Let's record it so we can watch it later. So you'll like open up a cupboard and there'll be like a list of movies in the cupboard. And you'll be like, oh my God, I recognize every single one of these movies. And I think I had a VHS tape with all of them on it too. Oh my God. And so like it was a trip down memory lane for me, but it was also like a really interesting experience and a really interesting story.
That's cool. Like I'm looking over the pictures and stuff that were in the link, and I can really appreciate this kind of stuff because of the narrative and how it's not handholding. Like some of the problems that I have with some of the video games, because I'm not a video game aficionado. Like I'm a casual gamer, and I'm trying to figure out, you know, as I play more games with Jocelyn, what I like, what I don't like. And story holes are a big issue for me. I also feel like being bombarded with too much story at once is also a negative because it's just a lot to remember. Like if it's not an existing universe that you're familiar with, then you have to introduce everybody to the universe slowly for it to sink in. And I find a lot of games kind of smack you over the head with like,
this is so not that experience at all.
Yeah, though this seems like a very, like you can only get as much as you can digest at a time because you're the one driving it.
Right. Yeah. And I've even gone back now. I finished it. It took me about 3 hours. And then I listened to a podcast where they discussed the game and they talked about four or five things I missed playing. Oh, wow. And I went back in and found those things just so I could say, oh, okay. Hmm. And it actually helped me put pieces of the puzzle together that I was missing.
Cool. Now, just like some of the movies that you might own on your shelf, I've got some movies that are things that I rewatch every couple of years. Something like Castaway or Thomas Crown Affair or things that you know how they end, but you don't necessarily remember every last little detail from point A to point B, depending right. on how many times you've seen it. If you only watch it like once every 3 or 4 years. Does this have that kind of replayability?
Yes.
Like, could you go back and play it in like 3 years? Is it so complicated that there's no way you're going to remember everything?
Oh, no. There's very simple controls. It's like walking around in a first-person shooter.
Oh, I don't mean the controls. I mean, like, the details of, like, you know, where the key was in the front porch and all that kind of stuff.
You'll forget.
Yeah.
There really isn't any puzzles. It's literally like you pick up something and you read it or it gets read to you. There's certain things that you pick up and you get a narration from the sister, like a journal entry, like her telling you a story. And that's the only dialogue the whole game. Other than that, you completely drive the experience. It totally explains everything to you. And it's very simple. And it's like so easy anybody could play. Hmm. And that was kind of what they wanted.
Cool. Yeah, no, that looks like it's a really cool thing to mention too in this section of the show, because it really, it's more of an interactive movie than it is a game.
It's actually something I can see myself going back and playing again in a year or two. Like, the story is actually so good, it actually, like, made me want to cry at the end.
Wow. Do you know if it's doing well?
It's doing fairly well. Yeah. It's getting a lot of critical praise. I've seen some people complaining about it, and most of them, it's mostly kids that bought it thinking it was, like,
first-person shooter.
Or something it's not. They were expecting, like, a puzzle game, and it's not.
It's
very story-driven.
Yeah. Kids want everything now. And they don't want to have to work for it. Yeah, I know what you mean. I'm the only thing that strikes me, even though I'm hearing, you know, a very good account of it from you, and obviously I trust your opinion on games, but the price point to me seems
high. Even the guys that released it, Fulbright, they've even said, listen, we know the price point's high. We're trying to make, they've spent 3 years making this game.
Right.
They did this four. It was made by four people, and they all worked for 2K Studios. They did an expansion to one of the BioShock games.
Okay.
And afterwards, while they really enjoyed working on the game, they felt like they had to ham-fist all the combat stuff, and they really just wanted to tell a story.
Right.
So all four of them moved to Oregon, lived in a house, and like made this game for like 2 years.
Wow.
And so this is like a project of love.
Yeah, passion project.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, at one point though, you kind of wonder whether if it was $14.99 or even $12.99, if they would be selling more and making more money.
They've already said that it's $20 now. They know it's too expensive for some people. They're going to make a point of making sure it's way more affordable on the next Steam sale.
Cool. Yeah, I just thought was my next question. Because I see on the website that is a Steam game, so Steam sale, I imagine, would be a big hit.
They've already said, we're going to make a point of making sure it's really low priced when there's a Steam sale. So
yeah, and things fly off the shelf, so to speak, in Steam sales. Right on. Very, very cool. Well, I really haven't been doing a whole lot outside of going to see Elysium because, we were entertaining friends all weekend. However, I did finish Justified Season 4. And I know I've mentioned Justified on the show before, so I won't go into any kind of great detail here. But I may be sticking my foot in my mouth because I can't remember exactly what I said on Hell on Wheels in previous weeks, or possibly even Justified already. But I feel like Justified might be the best show on TV right now.
I would agree with you. Oh. I haven't seen season 4. I've only seen up to season 3.
All right. Well, no spoilers. because I would not want to spoil anything for you. But all I can say is bad ass. I love how they treat the gray in good guy, bad guy in this show.
Right.
And it is fantastic. It's probably, I feel like season four starts off kind of weak, but it after a few episodes, they get into that, you know, season long story arc, and it's brilliant. Right. Just brilliant. If you haven't seen any of Justified, folks, like the first two seasons in Canada are on Netflix, and I don't know if all three or four seasons are on. I don't imagine season four is out on Netflix in the States, is it?
No.
No. But
no, it's not even out on DVD or Blu-ray here.
Right. Yeah, because season four just finished. Which is how I usually get it. Yeah. Because it's a winter show, I think, isn't it? It's like, doesn't start until March.
Right. I think it is a winter show.
Yeah. And they are picked up for season five, so it's coming back. But it is very, very good. I highly, highly recommend it. And if you can't tell, yes, I am on a Western kick. I'm aware. You know, Hell on Wheels and Justified, all that kind of stuff. But it's, definitely worth checking out. Right on. Well, I guess we can just keep on trucking. And this is a good place to stick, I guess, our Hemlock Grove chat. So spoiler warning, folks, Jocelyn and I have finished Hemlock Grove on Netflix, which is a Netflix exclusive series, all of which is available for you right now to go check out and watch. So there's no waiting for this. It's there. So, I dare you to try to not watch more than one in an evening.
Oh, it was addictive.
Yeah. It's one of those things where it does have a full arc. But we are going to get into some spoilers because Lou has seen the entire season, as have I. I believe, sir, it was you that turned us on to Hemlock Grove.
I think I recommended it one of the first times I guessed it on here.
I think you did. And I thank you because Joss and I really enjoyed it.
I was surprised because a lot of people were giving it like, it's okay. And I was like, really? I really like this.
The good outweighs the bad. And yeah. I can understand where people are coming from, but I'll give one last spoiler warning here before we continue, and then it's free for all. So if you haven't watched it, folks, bail, come back, join us later. I'll put the time code in the show notes so you can skip ahead and just be safe. But for now, we're going to dive into some Hemlock Grove. So the thing that I found about it on that note, Lou, with people liking it and not liking it, I think if you don't like horror movies, you're probably going to have a bit of a problem with the show.
Yeah, yeah.
And I am not a fan of horror movies, but I can deal with some, like, thrillers, like mystery thrillers, and, like, serial killer stuff, like Silence of the Lambs. Like, I thought that was great. I'm in the middle. And the difference for me is that most horror movies are kind of like B-movies. Like, they're really not well-acted or well-done.
Right.
It's more of a like gore porn, or it's just shocking you and making you feel uncomfortable for the sake of it. Hemlock Grove does what horror movies to me normally don't do, and that is captivate you with some story. Part of that is probably because there's 13 episodes, I think, which is much longer than your average 2-hour movie or 90-minute movie if it's a horror flick. And I think that's the difference. I think it's a well-done horror series. And because it's on Netflix, as we've mentioned before with things like House of Cards, the episodes don't have to be any specific length. So they can be as long as or as short or as, you know, poignant as they need to be. And they also have license for nudity, swearing, and gory, gory stuff that would never fly on TV. And I think that's what overall, I think that's what really sold me is that it's the right medium for this kind of story.
In case you didn't know, you do know that it is based on a book.
I do.
Okay. All right.
I do.
And,
yeah.
And the guy that did the book wrote most of the episodes.
Yeah. And then again, that's another thing I feel like Netflix does very well is that they work closely with the author. And they seem to retain a lot of input. In a similar way that HBO does with Game of Thrones and George R. R. Martin. I mean, like, he's heavily involved in the show. Probably the same thing with AMC and Walking Dead, you know, where, Kirkman Kirkman is really involved in the show in a way that he's even making changes that are different from the book because he wasn't happy with the book, you know, because he was limited and he wasn't satisfied by graphic novel stuff. Like, I feel like these extended cable channels like FX, AMC, HBO, and then now Netflix as a set-top box channel now really give an opening for, pardon me, for authors to have their vision realized in a way that is non-influenced by a commercial break every 15 minutes, a 13 to 26 episode series. Even though most Netflix stuff tends to be 13, I feel like that's just it's probably just a budgetary thing, because they're probably still, it's like they're bridging the gap between real world and, like, not real world, but traditional television broadcasting budgets and Netflix. You know, Netflix could want to do 16 episodes, but the budgets that are available are kind of like 13 or 26.
Yeah.
You know, so I can understand how they might have their hands tied there. But I feel like there's enough leeway there for them to cater to the author's vision if they work well together, if they find the right, you know, producer, director, original writer combo. I feel like they've got a lot of freedom.
I have to say, Netflix has really wowed me. I wasn't a huge fan of House of Cards, but I saw what they were doing with it, and it was really interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And everything they've done so far has just been like, wow, why do people have cable again? Remind me?
Mm-hmm.
Because if I was getting this kind of content all the time just from Netflix, I wouldn't need cable, which I'm a longtime cord cutter. So
same here. You know, we've been cord cutters for a long time. Myself before Jocelyn moved here, but I don't think Jocelyn had cable even when she was in Ontario, at least not in her place in Huntsville, because she had her Xbox, which had Netflix and, you know,
right,
favorite shows like Buffy, like, you know, things like, I mean, if you know what you like and there's seven or eight seasons of a show, then I mean, hey, why not, right? You don't really need it. The thing that I like so much about Netflix is where they're headed. Like, they're blazing a trail and they're doing it so well. Like, it's, you know, you always hate it when someone's coming out with like a next generation console or, you know, the next type of experience in video games, as far as like, say, Going Home or Gone Home.
Right. Right.
And you hate to see those things attempt to be very, very good and then just fall short of critical acclaim or the check marks that they need to become mainstream. And Netflix, you're right, is, I don't know if I'm surprised. If I am, I'm pleasantly surprised. I'm not shocked, but I'm happy that something that I like already is doing well. And something that I really like about these Netflix original series is of course that they're available in Canada, where a lot of the really cool stuff on Netflix in the States is just not available up here. Like, we don't get really current movies. It really depends on...
Can I say something?
Yeah.
I talked to half my friends online are from Canada, and then they tell me what they're watching on Netflix, and I think you guys get a way better selection than we
really?
Do down here.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, man.
You guys are always watching something that I'm like, really? You guys got that on Netflix up there? We don't have that here.
I guess the grass is always greener.
I've seen everything on Netflix at this point. So yeah. Whenever I'm always waiting for new content. And then I'll be talking to somebody and they'll be like, oh, I watch blah, blah, blah on Netflix. Oh.
The thing, I think the one little blip that we get is we tend to get BBC content before you do.
Yes.
And that of course is something that twists some people. Things like what was it called? It was a superhero show. Misfits. Yeah, we had that, I think, before you guys did. If you guys even got it.
We got it through Hulu.
Yeah, yeah. We'll see. Okay, and this is the thing. Netflix is the only thing we have up here. There's no Amazon Prime, there's no Hulu. So I can't watch primetime television a couple days later or a couple weeks later. I can't watch major motion pictures a few weeks later. Like, when you guys get DVD releases, my only option is to rent them on iTunes. Like, I can't. There's like, say, like, for example, Transformers 3, I think, is on Netflix, but Transformers 1 and 2 isn't, because it depends on which production company did it and when and what the licensing is.
Yeah, I don't think we have any of those at the moment.
Yeah, it's like, it's bizarre. And I mean, I understand that Netflix rotates its content and stuff like that, but it's a little bit tricky as far as the content goes, but anyway, I kind of a sideways conversation there, but you know, back to Hemlock Grove. What do you think are the strengths of the series? What really kind of...
The two lead main guys,
yeah,
Peter and Roman,
mm-hmm,
they kind of like, they steal the show.
Mm-hmm.
Like every time one of them is on camera, you can't help but be compelled by whatever's going on in the story.
Yeah, yeah.
I was totally surprised.
Yeah, and at first I had a hard time with Bill Skarsgård, the guy that plays Roman.
You do, yeah.
He's awkward.
Yeah.
But he's meant to be.
I think that's his charm.
Yeah, I think that's his character, too. Like, I think he's written to be aloof. And, I mean, well, they film him like a James Dean character, you know, from the 50s or 60s. Like, he's really kind of like the bad boy, the brooding, you know, puppy dog, pouty kind of, you know, kind of guy. He's also really, really tall.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so is all of his family.
Yes. Well, this is the thing. The whole time I'm watching this movie, this show, I'm going, I know this guy from somewhere. There's something about him that just absolutely rings a bell with me. And I looked him up on IMDb, but you got to be careful with shows like this because with Netflix isn't afraid to kill people. So I didn't want to spend too much time on IMDb only to look at a character next to him and find out that they're only in it for 4 episodes and go like, well, shit, I didn't want to know that he or she dies in the next couple episodes. So I was really putting off looking anything up on IMDb until after we finished. And as soon as I saw his last name, I went, I know that guy. I know that name. And it, no sooner than I had that realization that I was like, oh my God, if he's related to the guy on True Blood, then I'm going to shit a brick. And sure enough, they're brothers.
Yep. And his father is in Thor.
Is that, that's who he is too?
Yeah.
Oh my God.
And there's a third brother that does acting too somewhere.
You're
that
kidding.
I saw in a bit part somewhere.
So, I mean, I knew that it was a Norwegian name, or Swedish? I can't remember.
I believe they're Norwegian.
Yeah.
Or, so, no, this, they're, you're right, Sweden.
Sweden, yeah.
Yeah.
And I was like, I knew I recognized the name, and it's because I just watched Avengers with Jocelyn a couple weeks ago, and of course, Skarsgård is the guy that plays the professor. Man, that's so funny. I didn't realize they were all related. But man, I mean, Bill, I can't remember his older brother's name, but they don't so much look alike as much as they have the same build and the same physical stature and mannerisms. Like, their arms are like 8 feet long. And they stand in this kind of weird, kind of crooked, pinched shoulder way, and it's very off-putting and very aloof. It's an interesting kind of physical presence in a show, and weird that they're both essentially vampires from what I can tell.
Yeah, big spoiler.
Well, yeah, we warned everybody.
They hint to you the whole show that there's something weird about him, and the whole show I'm like, he's got to be a vampire of some kind, but considering that the werewolves in this are very unique,
mm-hmm,
I was like, the vampires are going to be weird too.
Mm-hmm.
And boy, are they.
Yeah. Well, and I didn't understand, like, they weren't necessarily like blood sucking vampires. They seemed to be just meat eaters.
Yeah.
Like raw flesh sort of stuff.
Yeah.
And mean, to say the least. But I mean, well, I guess we can break it down. So there's like the werewolf thing happening with Peter, who is a gypsy, also a very good actor, Landon Laborian. He was in Terra Nova. I didn't even realize it was the same guy.
He's a
very good actor. He plays this kind of drifter Peter character really, really well. There's Roman, who's what do they call them? Au pair?
Something like that.
Well, and that's the other thing. Do they kind of lead you off by having different names for them than traditional, like Nosferatu or vampire or whatever?
Right.
So Roman and his mother, Olivia, are kind of the au pair people. There's a sister, her name's Shelley, and she's kind of like the Frankenstein monster, so to speak, on a it's genetically enhanced stuff that saved her life. And so she has this kind of Frankenstein thing going on.
And she just looks weird. And when they mostly keep her, the hair covering that freaky eye.
At first.
Every time she brushes her hair out of her eye, you're like, oh, please put it back.
They do so well with the makeup and the CG on that. Like, man, does it ever look real?
Yeah, it kind of, like the first time I was like, oh, I hope they don't keep showing her face. And then you kind of slowly adjust to it. And you're like, okay, I it's not as gross anymore. It's okay. Yeah.
Well, it's because she smiles and she's got braces. You know, like she's the actor that plays her, Nicole Beauvin. She plays the face acting. There's a different girl altogether that plays the body actor because, of course, she's taller than
right.
Bill Skarsgård, who's quite tall. He's like 6'4", 6'5", or something.
Yeah.
So this chick in high heel boots is much bigger as a body double because Nicole Beauvin is only like 5'4". But she's got a very cute face and she's very expressive because Shelley can't talk. And I had Nicole on my list of really good acting in the show because she gets so much across with a blink or a smile or a blush or, you know, something. You know, because otherwise she just kind of wheezes and grunts, you know, as far
and
as her
actual... And she becomes really endearing really quickly.
Yeah, she does. Yeah. Well, she's the innocent, right? Like, she's...
Right.
She's growing up in a hurry, and no one seems to be noticing. And that, I think, is what you really feel for her, is as the world speeds by around her, you're just like, oh my God, this chick, this poor kid is just experiencing so much. So much. I'm trying to think about some other guys that I really enjoyed. Aaron Douglas is Tom Sworn. He's the sheriff.
Yep.
And he's a favorite of mine from Battlestar Galactica.
Yeah, and he always plays this same role. Like, everything I've ever seen him in, he's always kind of this sheriff guy.
Yeah, I guess so. He wasn't really a sheriff in Battlestar, but I haven't seen him in anything else.
I've seen him in other stuff, and he's always kind of like a cop. Or
right.
a detective.
Working
or,
man, stiff upper lip sort of thing.
Yeah, yeah. And so when I saw him in this, I was like, okay, I know what I'm in for with him.
Yeah. And I found him more emotional in this, though.
Yeah.
In a good way. Yeah.
He and his daughters were interesting.
Oh, my God. I mean, kudos to them for being so obnoxious so consistently.
Yeah. Like, you want to throttle them as soon as you see them. You're like, oh... He's got two daughters that are like
14 or something.
Yeah. And it's like, and they look alike. They dress alike. They do everything alike. And you're like, oh, I remember people like this when I was in high school.
Mm-hmm.
I hated them.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. They like speak in unison, complete each other's sentences. And
yeah.
And they're just, what's the word? Like, just vapid little bitches. Like, they're not nice people.
No, not at all. But he always, his opinion of them is they're like his little angels, and you're like, they're not angels.
No, not at all. Not at all. I mean, I remember looking at Jocelyn when we were watching this show, and she just looked at me, and she's like, boys, when we start a family, boys.
Yup.
I was like, all right. I was like, I guess that's up to me. I thought it was pretty funny, but I was thinking the same thing. Cause like, oh my God, I can't imagine having like twins that are 14, like today. Like, and well, the whole show was like that. Like Peter being the outlier, I feel like everybody in the show, and I've mentioned this before, was this vapid, self-absorbed teenager that drank, smoked, slept around, didn't give two shits about anybody else. And it felt accurate. Like,
yeah.
It's the farthest thing from Dawson's Creek, you know, or Diaries, Vampire Diaries, or True Blood, or, I mean, True Blood's about adults. But, you know, like, it's so far removed from the stuff that you get on WB and NBC and all that kind of stuff. And it felt a lot more real.
Even when the characters did something that seemed unreal, the way it was portrayed, you were like, yeah, I could see somebody... Mm-hmm. doing that.
Yeah. And that's the thing is like once, cause you're what, two or three episodes in before they actually reveal, yes, there's going to be monsters in the show. Peter really is a werewolf, even though there's kind of jokes and stuff about it. And he denies it for the first couple episodes, but then you get to watch him change, which was crazy. Which is one of my big pros about the show is the effects, the way that they handle, the visual effects, both practical and CG stuff is fantastic. They really go a long way to show you just enough, let you hear just enough without seeing, so you kind of really get a feel for what's going on. And if you've seen Van Helsing, one of my favorite things about Van Helsing was how the people turn into werewolves. They basically, the werewolf comes from within and they tear off the human skin.
Right.
And then vice versa. I think that's how they turn back into people too. But in this, after Peter is done pushing his eyeballs out of his sockets and replacing them with wolf eyes and having the muzzle of the wolf come out through his own mouth and break his jaw, like it's just, it's visceral. He then is left with this pile of human stuff in front of him as a wolf, which he eats.
Yep.
It's disgusting. Like, it's just, it is, it's got
rough
this,
to watch the first time.
Yeah, and it's got this whole, what's the word I'm looking for? I mean, there's something, they're saying something there about, like, him constantly eating himself as he changes. Like, it's just bizarre. It's disturbing, gross. It's all at once. It just kind of hits you like, wow, I'm, it doesn't glorify being a werewolf. You're like, I am really glad I'm not one of those.
Yeah, like, it's totally not Twilight and all that stuff.
Yeah, oh, exactly.
It's like, these characters are monsters, and they really are monsters. Mm-hmm. Like, you don't, there's nothing charming about them.
Yeah, and I'm glad that they went the route of having them turn into actual wolves and not wolf man.
Right.
Because I have yet to see a show that can do that. Like, unless you have the budget to do a full CG werewolf, you are not going to sell anybody on a dude in a rubber suit.
Nope.
Not these days. And what was that show from BBC that was remade in America? There's a wolf, a werewolf, a ghost, and a vampire. They all live together.
Oh, I know exactly what you're talking about. Being Human?
Being Human, thank you. That I enjoyed the actor that played the werewolf in that, but when he turned into a werewolf, immediately you're like, oh God, okay, this doesn't... The change right. was okay looking because they had him in a couple different prosthetics, but once he was actually a werewolf, it's like, oh, he can't turn his head.
You yeah, know, exactly.
Like that kind of stuff. You're like, nah, you kind of lost me. That I think you'd be better off with just having somebody with a glove on that has a claw and just not showing anything, maybe showing an animated silhouette and just kind of like leaving the rest up to people's imagination, I think would be more interesting. But they don't in this. They do a very good job of showing all that kind of stuff. I was still really confused as to what Olivia was and what the au pair really were, with their mind control and their bloodlust and their like meat habits and stuff like that. They don't appear to be traditional vampires because they walk around in the daylight all the time, for starters.
Yeah, my wife thought that they were more like dragons than vampires.
Oh, and that's what they call them, too, don't they?
Yeah, yeah. Yes, something like that. But they technically, they kind of are vampires, but there's some weird stuff there that kind of leads you to believe that maybe... vampires aren't what we think they are, kind of thing.
And yeah. Yeah. No, you're... Yeah. I can see that. I can see how it would go. Because something that... in the very last episode, there's this flashback of Olivia, I think, cutting a tail off or something?
Yes.
And I didn't understand. Like, I don't remember there ever being a big deal about a tail. It seemed kind of thrown in. Like, I didn't understand the weight of it that it was supposed to portray. I mean, they show her scar a couple times, but I was like, well, what the hell is that supposed to mean? Like, I don't
right.
know. I didn't really understand why. Did you catch that? Did you pick up anything there?
I did catch it, but I was kind of like, huh, that's strange. Vampires have tails in this world. Okay.
Yeah. So, I mean, they might be something just a little bit different.
It seems to borrow the ideas and the lore from different places than they normally do in stories like this. So
yeah.
Every time there was a weird twist, I was like, oh, okay. This is breaking tradition in a good way. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm surprised.
I felt that too. And I think that's probably what it was, is like, it sticks with some familiarity enough that you can start to piece things together. Johnson and I figured out who the monster was like one or two episodes before they revealed it.
Yeah, I kind of figured it out going into that episode, but I still wasn't 100% sure.
No, I had a couple of people in mind, and it wasn't until the very last episode, right before they revealed it, that I actually knew what was going on. I didn't know how.
Right.
I just kind of figured out, yeah, this is just the way that things go. And it, for me, what it was a combination of either, unfortunately, her not-so-great acting, the girl that plays Christina, but I don't know whether that's her or whether it's the lines in her direction. I mean, like, if she is meant to be really weird and awkward, she does very well.
Right.
But there's some things that it just feels like she's reading because they've written language for her that it's just beyond her age level. Well, right. Not the actor, but the character in the story feels young to be speaking the way that she does.
Right. And that, she's supposed to be a writer, and then she uses words and stuff that I'm like, it feels like they're showing off.
Yeah, it's pretentious. It's not believable, and it's only because she starts to act so weird, like Roman, like Peter, like Olivia. That's when I really started to say, "All right, she's a monster," because she's acting as awkward and strange as the rest of them. And that's when I sort of clued in as to what was going on. When did you figure it out? What was the thing that dropped for you?
It was just there wasn't enough people left.
Yeah.
And blaming it on other people just didn't seem to make sense. She seemed to be the only person that would fit.
Yeah.
And then the last, what was it? The two girls that were her friends were the last to die.
Yeah.
I think before that. And I was like, wait a minute. If they're dead, the only person that would have killed them would have probably been her. And it was at that point I kind of pieced it together.
Yeah, I thought it actually might have been Olivia for the longest time.
Yeah, that was who I thought it was almost the entire show.
Yeah.
I was like, it's got to be her, got to be her, got to be her. And then, like, maybe two episodes before, I kind of suspected maybe two or three other people. And then they all started getting bumped off one by one. And I was like, oh, maybe it's not that person.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there was even a little while there where I thought it might have been Peter.
Yeah.
Like, he wasn't aware. They kind of lead you that direction about halfway through the series.
They every time you think it's somebody, they do a good job of kind of throwing you off the trail.
Mm-hmm.
And then making you think maybe it's this person.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And even those people kind of think maybe it is me and I don't know it, kind of. And it makes you really go, huh, maybe.
Yeah, because even Roman was a target for a little while until he got knocked unconscious one night and somebody died. It's like, all right, well, it wasn't him.
Right.
You know, like, and you're right, like, slowly the process of elimination. I would imagine it was probably much harder to tell in the book.
Yeah.
Than it would be in the TV series because of all the visual cues.
I have not read the book, but the show definitely made me want to.
I'm curious. Yeah, I'd like to check out the book to see what was going on. So, what about the show did you not like?
Roman's mother's accent was awful.
Horrendous.
And every time she spoke, it kind of took me out of the whole scenario.
I think it was limiting her acting, too. Because normally Famke Janssen is pretty good. But yeah. I was not impressed. I mean, I understand she's like a drug addict, dragon, monster, rich person, eccentric. But it still wasn't quite enough for me. She felt like a character. As opposed to the other people just being teens with interesting problems.
And as much as I liked the uncle, some of the choices he made seemed a little like, just, why are you doing this?
However, the one thing that I kept on having to tell myself is that she is an au pair too, and she was messing with his mind.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So that's how I kind of justified some of his really poor choices, is because she's got him just wrapped, just completely mind controlled into whatever she wants to do with him. There was something about him that I found really interesting too. Well, because he's the reverse. He's a British actor.
Right. Doing an American accent.
And you could barely tell.
Yeah.
Barely tell. But he, because of that transition from British to American, he had to speak just a little bit slower, I think.
Yeah.
And it made him have that weird kind of omnipresence of like, of, I mean, he's playing a psychiatrist, so he has that kind of, why do you feel that way? Kind of, not condescension, but, you know, he always speaks in just clear, crisp sentences because he's concentrating on what he's saying. And it, I felt it, even though I noticed it, I felt it kind of added to his character a little bit.
I agree with you 100% on that.
Yeah, it was an interesting twitch. I feel like some of the cons for me were the love interest between Peter and Letha.
Yeah.
Also, Letha, worst name ever.
Every time they said it, I would be like, I want to gouge my ears out. I hate that name.
Yeah.
It is such a...
Yeah, well, and even Jocelyn said, it's like Lisa with a lisp. She was joking, and then the next episode, they actually say that line, and both Jocelyn and I had a good hoot over it. At least they understand that it's pretty dumb, and they needed to address it. But and there were some funny moments in the show. They do keep it light at some particular beats. But
yeah, like it would get really, really dark, and then something would happen, and it would make you laugh.
Yeah, and it would be the boys, usually Peter and Roman having some off-color conversation about something really inappropriate, and you're just going, dudes, oh, boys.
It was like, yeah, there's a coping mechanism.
Yeah, yeah. Anyway, the girl that plays Letha couldn't act her way out of a cardboard box. And
I gotta agree with you.
Yeah, and I mean, she seems like a nice kid, but they put her in a horrible, horrible role.
I've seen her in other stuff.
Oh, really?
I can't remember what, but I saw her in something when she was a kid, I think.
Mm.
And she was much better in whatever it was I saw.
Yeah.
Because I was like, I recognize her, and I don't remember her being this bad.
Yeah, well, the whole show has got this awkward tweak to it, so it's hard. I mean, maybe some actors just have a hard time doing awkward because they're trained all the time to be believable. And,
right.
And maybe being this weird, awkward thing isn't great. But, I mean, in the show, she believes that she's pregnant and has been impregnated by an angel. And you don't really know what to think of that, given how much supernatural stuff is happening in the show.
Right.
But I don't believe for a second that a teenager, gypsy, vagabond, or otherwise, would be into a pregnant teen who he isn't the dad. Like, call me whatever you want. I didn't find that believable at all.
I was willing to suspend my disbelief because he was a werewolf, and I didn't know what that meant.
I don't know what werewolves are into either, but yeah, but,
it was like, all right, I'll give him the benefit of the doubt for now.
Yeah, like, I don't know. I didn't really get it. Didn't really get it at all. The last episode also kind of bugged me too. I felt like I was kind of beat over the head with all of the puzzle pieces that we were trying to put together the whole series. And the best... Sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say, they did that for a reason. They did not know until maybe 6 weeks ago if they were even going to have a second season.
Right. And that is precisely what Jocelyn said to me. And it feels... It's like she's experienced other seasons of shows before where they're finishing up a season and they don't know where they're getting renewed, so they have to tie everything in a pretty little bow. And that's exactly what it felt like. It felt like, oh, well, we were hoping we were going to know sooner, but we don't. So this is our plan B season ender. There's not going to be a cliffhanger. Well, maybe a little one, but most of the stuff that you've been asking yourself, we're just going to tie up really nice with, like, not a montage episode, but it's like
like a 5-minute tie up.
Yeah, it's like a it's like a voiceover where Olivia is talking about her childhood and her upbringing and revealing all to Roman, who doesn't know who or what he is,
right?
But does now. So yeah, it's I did have a bit of a problem with that.
I was really excited when I heard that the second season was renewed because I really liked this, and I watched it back in April when it first premiered.
Mm.
And I was the only person I know that was like, yeah, this is really good. You should watch it. And then I'd be like, oh, yeah, I'll get around to it. That's that werewolf thing, right? Yeah. Okay. And I was like, no, it's better than that. I'm telling you. And they're like, yeah, okay. Right, that's nice.
Yeah.
And then all the critics kind of like either loved it or they were meh. And I was like, it's better than that. Second season would be good.
I can see that division. You know, I can see the division of critics being either all for it or not at all.
Yeah.
You know, like you kind of have to appreciate the horror genre to appreciate Hemlock Grove.
Well, I'm also a huge mystery fan. So right off the bat, when I was like, oh, there's a killer on the loose. Who is it? Let's figure it out.
Yeah.
Like the detective hat in me came out and went, oh, okay, you can solve this before the last episode.
Yeah, and I think that you were the one that described it to me as like Twin Peaks, but modern and creepy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I still haven't watched Twin Peaks. We haven't even finished the pilot.
Don't finish the pilot. Watch it till about the arrest sequence towards the end, and then don't find out who the killer is.
Ah.
Because there was a... I will warn you now. There is an error where they couldn't air the show in Europe, so they reveal the killer at the end of the pilot episode because it was a film in Europe.
Oh.
And what ended up happening was nobody has the rights to the actual original first episode, so you get the movie, and you find out who the killer is if you finish the first episode.
Oh, crap. Okay, well, we'll skip it then.
So the best bet is to kind of, like, watch it to about... There's a kid that gets arrested, and after he kind of gets arrested... Stop watching and watch the next episode.
Yeah, I feel like we're about halfway through and we're just like, God, we've been watching this for like an hour and there was like an hour plus left. I was like, oh, screw this.
Yeah, you watch it till like maybe three quarters through, maybe, and then stop.
All right, I'll give it another go. That's if it even is still on Netflix. I'm not sure.
Oh, it probably is. It's one of those things that won't go away.
Yeah. Nice. That's one way to look at it. Right on. Well, before we move on, any final thoughts from you on Hemlock Grove?
No, if you haven't seen it and you've listened to this, I hope we've enticed you into watching it.
Mm-hmm. I don't think we've spoiled a lot. I mean, we've certainly told you the major plot points, but there's still a lot of really nice weaving that happens in between. That's worth checking out.
It's a one continuous story. Even when they do kind of do like little episode breaks, the stories get wrapped up real quick and it's more of a continuous story.
So. Yeah. Yeah, and that continuous thing is still always happening in the background.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Right on. Well, let's move into the end of the show here with the internet pick. And I've got a set of photographs that unfortunately are not that easily conveyed over the radio, but in sticking with our Hemlock Grove creepy theme, my cousin's wife posted this on Facebook. And it's not very often I click through on stuff, but I could not resist the headline. Abandonment issues, creepy photos of doctor's deserted mansion with exam room littered with instruments and microscope slides containing slices of human kidneys. And it's a photo set from, I don't know where, some crazy place, looks like overseas from the look of it, Germany. And
yeah, it's pretty spooky.
It is spooky. Like, it kind of makes me feel like doing like creepy paintings or... it's the stuff that you'd seen in like a post-apocalyptic video game that's set in that kind of time frame, or some of the houses that you walk through when you're playing, you know, Call of Duty, like the World War II versions.
Right.
And it's just like, it's amazing how, like, when they say abandoned, it, like, it looks like people just left. Like, everything was still there. It's obviously been probably like ransacked by thieves or something like that at some point, but... like everything is completely untouched, like the wallpaper, pots and pans and a wood stove, the size of the rooms. I mean, it doesn't hurt that the photographer did an extremely good job of capturing these very creepy moments of like this tattered stroller with a doll in it. And even the doll looks like it's in pain. Like it's just out of sight.
It's the stuff that nightmares are made of.
Yeah, like there's boxing gloves in the back of the chair, and then there's a guitar that's broken with an oil lamp next to it, and like there's just all these kind of crazy, creepy things that are all over the place, like the paint peeling and tiles falling off the wall, and like the stretcher is, the operating table is still there, and there's, like, it's the kind of thing that you expect to be kidnapped, go under, and wake up with clockworks in your innards, you know, like, it's just really, really out of this world stuff. Like, I don't think Hollywood could even dream up this stuff, you know, like, it's just crazy. So, I highly recommend that you check it out. I'll have the link in the show notes. It's in the chat room right now, and go freak yourself out with some real-world abandonment issues. What about you, sir? What is your pick?
My pick is saltybet.com. This got turned on to me by a video game website. It is sort of video game related. There is a guy who created a video stream. It's called Salty Bet. And the video stream is random video game characters and TV characters and comic characters get paired together like a fighting game. And you take bets on who's going to win the fight and then watch them duke out like a fighting game. And some of it is weird. Some of it you'll be like, why is there an 8-bit guy fighting a guy that is 32-bit? But okay, let's see where this goes. And it's some of it's wild, and I'm baffled sometimes because it shows characters. I'm like, I don't even know what this is, but that guy looks cool, so I'll bet on him. And all the money you bet is fake. It gives you fake money to bet with. And all the odds are based on what the bets are, and it calculates the odds and tells you what your odds of how much money you'll win if you win the bet. And it's really neat, and it's clever, and it's a good way to kill an hour.
Is it just a random, you don't know it's who
just,
wins?
It's just random. Like, you'll see, it'll be like, Mario versus, and then it'll say, somebody from Mass Effect.
Right.
And you'll be like, what? Okay. And then it'll be like, Mickey Mouse versus, and then it'll be like
Venom,
Donkey Kong.
Yeah.
And you'll be like, what? And then I was watching it the other night while I was writing, and it was Hanna-Barbera cartoon characters versus somebody else, and I was like, what? I didn't even... Okay. And it's some pet project by some guy. He just programmed this fighting game and stuffed all these characters in it. There's 1,700 characters, 500 backgrounds borrowed from various fighting games and stuff, and half the characters are made by him, half the characters are adaptations of other things. It's really interesting.
Wow. I would imagine he's breaking some copyright laws, even though I know he's not making any money.
There is some questions about that, but nobody has filed any cease and desists on him yet.
Yeah. I mean, the fact that he's not making any real money off of it is probably what's saving him.
I think it's parity law that he's working with.
Yeah, that's what I was just about to say. It seems kind of like, because he's altering the characters and doing all the silly stuff with them, I feel like it might fall under that.
Yeah, I think he's getting away with parity law.
Yeah, he's probably taking the sprites and stuff from existing games and changing them in a couple of ways in order to move far enough. Because if he was just repurposing the sprites, he would probably have a problem there.
Right.
But because he's changing, like, I just saw Venom with a scorpion tail, and I don't ever remember any video game with a scorpion tail. And now I'm watching someone who is clearly a Street Fighter type character from an anime game fighting a stick man.
It really
is a stick man. He's got like a circle for a head and a red box for a hat, and he's got like sticks and arms. And I don't know how well he's going to do, but it's quite amusing.
It's fun to watch if you got an hour to kill and you're just looking for something to do. It's worth watching.
Yeah, it's a strange screen though. It's like a vertical, looks like an iPhone screen or something. It's a weird layout on, at least in Safari, how I'm looking at it.
I think it's based on the Dreamcast. Something to do with the Sega Dreamcast. I think it's all running on a Dreamcast or something.
Yeah. Anyway, so I'm getting this little box of a video inside of this really tall, narrow black box, and then there's a chat room on the side.
Yeah. And don't bother with the chat room.
Well, no, I figured it was...
It's full of trolls.
Yeah, well, I figured it would... I thought it was fake anyway. Yeah, I thought it was fake. But anyway, very, very unique pick. We don't see stuff like that very often around here.
No,
so.
I was afraid. I didn't know what it was. I read a whole article on it. I was like, is it a game? What is it? And then I was at a friend's house and they were watching it. And I was like, oh, this is what it is. I get it now.
Right on. Well, I think it's time to wrap up the show. Thank you, everyone, for tuning in live. If you happen to be swinging by our live page on Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern, you can find us at joelduggan.com/live. There's a live chat room. There's a stream. You can come hang out with myself and Lou or another guest, as I seem to have several these days. You can find the show on thecitadelcafe.com. That is, of course, where you will find show notes, the audio on demand, as well as on iTunes. Music for the Citadel Cafe was composed by Kevin MacLeod. And, of course, you can email or contact the show via Gmail, Twitter, Facebook, or Google+. Just the name of the show, the Citadel Cafe, is the best way to find us. Don't forget on Friday nights, speaking of video games, to check out the Gamers In podcast every Friday night at 8:30 p.m. Eastern on amove.tv. If you're a gamer, tune in to Jocelyn and Ryan as they break down their opinions on the latest gaming news and what they're playing. Also, they had a late episode this weekend because of GamesCon, so they recorded Monday night. So there's a new episode up, and then they're recording again Friday night. So to wrap up the week, you can find more at gamersinpodcast.com or at amove.tv/TGI. As I mentioned at the top of the show, my name is Joel Duggan. You can find everything that I am up to online at joelduggan.com. That includes my book, StarCrossed Volume 1, which is available in my web store. You can also follow me on Twitter and Google+ with just my name. Where can people find you online, my friend Lou?
Well, the easiest way to find me is I am Busy Zombie Lord on Twitter. I'm a co-host of Zombies Ate My Podcast. I also do a regular column on old video games at Games Are Evil, as well as do some reviews now over there. And stay tuned to my Twitter feed. There may be a new podcast showing up soon.
Ooh, fun. I'm intrigued. Ladies and gentlemen, you have been listening to the Citadel Cafe, where we are fast, easy, and cheap, but you can only pick two.